Good afternoon. My name is Akua Asare-Anim, and I'm one of the International Recruitment Specialists with the Marketing and Undergraduate Recruitment Department and a proud graduate of the University of Waterloo. And today, I'll be your host. I moved to Canada from Ghana roughly 15 years ago, and I very much appreciate that here in Canada, we acknowledge this land and its history. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge the land on which the University of Waterloo is located and from which most of us are streaming in into today's event. The University of Waterloo acknowledges that much of our work takes place on the traditional territory of the Neutral, Anishinaabe, and Haudenosaunee people. Our main campus is situated on the Haldimand Tract, the land granted to the Six Nations that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River. Our active work towards reconciliation takes place across our campuses through research, learning, teaching, and community building, and is centralized within our Indigenous Initiatives Office. A couple housekeeping items before we begin. Today's research and learning session will have 3 speakers, each having a 15-minute time slot. We would love to engage with you today, so please do not hesitate to put your questions in the question and answer box, and these will be addressed at the very end of the presentations. I would like to thank you for joining us and taking a moment with us today. I just want to mention that this video may be subject to technical interruptions. So in the unlikely occurrence that this video fails or shut down or is lagging, we do invite you to log back in and we will continue. However, if you aren't able to stay with us the entire hour, this live streaming event is being recorded and will be uploaded on the Ujima Black History Month website for future reference. It is my pleasure today to be in the company of individuals who have walked paths and shared experiences. Experiences, journeys, and stories that are their own and those of others. They live and share these experiences today to showcase a collective mosaic of our Black culture and its interrelations and connections within the Canadian space. I hope during these talks, we are able to allow ourselves to understand the historical and generational spaces involved, and also allowing us to reimagine our preconceived ideals and experiences. As we set the stage today, we are allowing others to embrace their struggles, victories, failures, triumphs, and adversity. It is my hope that the experiences shared today in this space not only sit with you, but live on in how we rethink, reshape, and re-explore Black History Month and every other month before and after it. My first speaker is Nancy Reeves, Associate Director, Equity, Diversity, Inclusion, and Anti-Racism here at the University of Waterloo. Nancy is a native of Liberia who arrived in Canada as a war refugee in 2000. She has a wealth of experience as college professor, social worker, clinical therapist, and human rights advocate. She is completing a PhD in social work education focused on the trauma of war and its implications for social work education and practice. Please help me in welcoming Nancy Eleanor Reeves.
Thank you so much, Akua. Thank you. Today I will be speaking on equity in social work. Equity in social work. Next, please. I took this picture because you're looking at the diversity of wonderful pictures you can see there and how diversified our global world is. Next, please. The next slide. Yeah. So social work and equity. I know a lot of people say they are social workers. I think we all social workers. As a Christian, I'm never ashamed to say Jesus was even a social worker. You know, he fed the hunger. He raised the dead. He did wonderful social work around the world that I'm always proud to say. But when we look at equity in social work, it's not something that is well talked about. We talked a lot about equality, social work practice and equality, but now we're starting to put more focus on equity So the application of equity, it's very important here to education. Yeah, Waterloo is an educational environment. How do we embed equity in our policy practices and so forth? But it's also important, it raises a lot of important awareness when it comes to even understanding the differences between equity and inequality, to refocus our thinking about how we can apply it in our daily lives and even in our practices, but even in the classrooms. Next, please. So how do we define equity? The Council on Social Work Education defines equity as the perspective or mode of thinking that is exhibited by practitioners, I would say instructors, educators, practitioners or so, who call attention to patterns of inequity in students or individuals' outcomes. These practitioners are willing to take, is it possible to expand this, please? Is it possible to expand it? Oh, I don't think it can happen, it's okay. But they are willing to take on personal approach when it comes to institutional responsibility for assessing the issues these individuals experience. But it also requires that practitioners or service provider educators are race conscious of race. But when being conscious of race, we also looked at the historical context of these exclusionary practices amongst ourselves and even four important groups that involved women, indigenous people, people of color, and of course, individuals with disability. And we'll talk about sexual orientation and so forth. Next, please. So there are five actions when it comes to embedding equity or being more equity minded in our practices, whether in education or so. One is the awareness of racial identity, very important, but also the usage of disaggregated data to identify inequities on racial and ethnic lines. The next one is to reflect on racial and ethnic consequences of our practice. And those practices can be everywhere, as I said, in the classroom, you know, in our offices, where we work with clients or so forth. But we also exercise our agencies when it comes to producing racial and ethnic equity. Then lastly, we also view the classrooms, we say, as a space where we have racialized bodies that intersect, the intersectionality of those racial bodies within that space, that we can do a lot of self-monitoring, right, and interaction with our clients, with students and individuals that we serve. Next, please. Next, please. So with respect to awareness, it's also important that social workers or those practitioners engage in self-assessment towards the self-awareness through the lens of humility, very important. We do some critical culture competence. It's very important, which persists. We say that awareness, knowledge, and skills are not only enough, but doing what empowerment and what anti-oppressive work. But specifically, those awareness actions, we need to consider structural oppression, right? We talk about the historical nature. We talk about structural oppression as well as our personal reflection on our practices. So we also practice, some authors have said, like Casado, that practice without the use of critical culture competence lens, it becomes very ineffective. So we need to deepen our understanding of the marginalization that those traditionally oppressed individuals have experienced. Next, please. Do you have questions, Ikwa? Oh, I can move. Yeah. So we also take into consideration those personal and institutional responsibility for the success of our clients, our individuals, and I keep mentioning with Waterloo, with our students, but we also critically assess our own practice through how we engage in our reflective work. Then also we do a lot of reflection that entails investigating our interactions. We do a lot of retrospection right, with respect to those given historical and cultural, linguistic and other political contexts that we worked in. The focus here, I would say, is placed on those various factors, such as those spoken, non-verbal and verbal involvement or emotional well-being of individuals. Then we also look at those central questions as to ourselves, as to equity-minded practice. We look at the knowledge and skills that we bring to our practice and how we make use of those with respect to our decision-making. Lastly, in so doing, we say equity-minded instructors, professors, teachers, practitioners calls for those tenets of anti-oppressive practice. It also calls for our engagement, as we said, with being reflective, self-aware. That can happen, we say, between the space in which we find ourselves working in. Next, please. So the use of data, I would say, is very important to the work we do because they help us produce outcomes. And yeah, Waterloo, we talked about the equity data survey that we are carrying out here to get to understanding the demographic of individuals on our campus, and hopefully the end result would be how we provide meaningful services to them. But continuing to reflect on, we say, those differential consequences of our different clients, right, within the social context and the social identities. But we also looked at, the intersectionality of individuals that may be, we say, described as engaging in line with our practice. Next, please. So equity-minded practitioner would say we are to exercise our personal agency. That means our capacity to act freely and produce or promote equity for disadvantaged group or population. That would be specific, very clear, direct actions and at our practice level. We also need to recognize within the process within those practice contexts that might be, for example, with racialized individuals based on their gender identity, in order to engage them and come up with meaningful actions and discussions. Next, please. So you can expand it, right? So in order to do an equity-minded work, I'll just read the one I can see here. We need to be able to influence the world in which we live. Our social location is very important. Next, please. Then we need to seek out professional development, very important, I'm sure, at Waterloo, very important, the equity office here at Waterloo. We just, from a meeting discussing that, how we can develop and expand on our knowledge, because research and things keeps coming up. We also need to get involved in those data for results. And we, it's very small, I can really read on it. But we also talked about the need for the expansion of, we need to cultivate cultural humility. That's exactly, thank you so much. Great. We need to search for that path, we say, that will allow us to advance equity practice in our programs, services, policies, and of course, community relations as we engage individuals. But we need to draw on, we say, those data within our organization. We need to also learn about those groups that we consider who are experiencing inequity or in an equity, who are part of the groups that we're looking at with respect to equity. We need to consider that, but we need to utilize those data. We need to create tangible, implementable approaches. And we talk about anti-oppressive approach, we talk about intersectionality within our practices, in order to support those needing those services. We need to, we say, identify and implement those strategic resources when it comes to centering those who are very important to our practices. Most the individualizer, we move it now to people of color, of course, women, indigenous people. We need to cultivate, we say, the network of social work practitioners who are equity-minded. But as I said, we all need to be equity minded, whether we are professors, teachers, teaching assistants, individuals working in the spaces of providing equity, in order to partner with say, and promote equity in our global or wider society. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nancy, for those insightful recommendations. My next speaker is Erin Francis. Erin is a doctoral student at the Balsillie School of International Affairs, specializing in global political economy. As founder and curator, Erin has exhibited works from his Vintage Black Canada initiative at the Band Gallery in Toronto, at the University of Waterloo Art Gallery, and at the Art Gallery of Ontario. Currently, Erin is producing a documentary about his Juno Award-winning uncle, Kitchener-Waterloo's own Errol Starr. Erin, the virtual stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that introduction. Thank you, Nancy, for your insight and your presentation as well. I'm happy to be here. I am a student of UWaterloo, an alum, and a current doctoral student, as was said. But I'm here in the context of my initiative, Vintage Black Canada. And Vintage Black Canada is something I started. We're in the third year now. When my grandfather, who was one of the go-to photographers in Kitchener-Waterloo for Black folks. He arrived here in the 60s with the technical ability and a passion for photography, for taking photos and collecting photos. And in doing so, he amassed an archive that, unfortunately, when he passed, he let me inherit. And I wonder if at this time, Megan, I could ask you to quickly show, right. So just to give some context, top left screen is an exhibit that I did in Toronto, and those are a number of images. Some of my grandfather's, others are curated from the family. Far right is an exhibit also in Toronto. Bottom left, CTV clip. So I was asked to talk about, thank you so much, Megan, you can remove that. I was asked to talk about my project, I think not just essentially within the context of Blackness and how it connects myself to my culture. And I think I have a number of examples doing this project. As I said, when my grandfather passed away and leaving me these photos, when I stumbled upon them, I was just awe-inspired by some of the quality of the work. Not only my grandfather's, he definitely achieved a certain level of professionalism, but the ones that he collected, he just adored Black beauty. And so we have photos going back 100 years, you know, my family in Panama. And my family background is Jamaican. But yeah, we have photos of Jamaicans in Panama and that sort of thing. And as well in England, where my family spent some time when they migrated from Jamaica to Canada. And connecting to my grandfather was very possible once I had these images. It filled a place in my heart, but it also helped me reconnect with my community and reminded me of myself and what makes me who I am today. And it's rare, I really truly believe, to grow up, to spend one's entire life, you know, to be born in Canada, but to be raised in a community that was fully Jamaican. And it's so funny that I think at some point in my life as a youth, I took for granted my Jamaicanness. You know, by the age of 14, I had already been to Jamaica three times. I had never gone anywhere else. It was just Kitchener-Waterloo, Jamaica. And then there's a certain point in my life where I said, oh, you know, I want to go to Asia. I want to do this. I want to learn about this thing. I want to learn about that. And then you forget that, yo, man, nothing can top Jamaica. It's really something that, and I say that, you know, facetiously, with all due respect to, you know, every culture, but it was just great to be reminded, you know, also inherited my grandfather's records, and just watching this, just looking at the styles and just looking at the cultural output of my peoples in Kitchener-Waterloo specifically. It was it was uplifting, and also I would say was humbling. I grew up in a time period wherein, as was mentioned, I'm working on a documentary of my uncle, and I grew up in a time period where it was normal to see like, oh, there's another Jamaican on TV winning an award. It was my uncle winning, Juno. It was the highest accolade he could win as a musician in Canada. And at the same time, I'm seeing Lennox Lewis, who was also Jamaican, is also Kitchener, receiving the gold medal for Canada, getting the key to the city. I'm watching, despite, you know, what they ended up doing to Ben Johnson, for example. It's just like, by the time I was, 10 years old, I had seen Jamaicans just do it all. And somehow along the way, I've forgotten about all that. And so that is sort of the first, I would say, example of how the archive was able to help me reconnect with my community and reconnect with Blackness. A second example is through media. When I started doing this project, it was Black media that first paid attention, and I'm forever grateful for that. And that was reaching out to me within a professional context out of genuine curiosity. And then, but more to the point, this is an archive that's currently housed strictly on Instagram, Vintage Black Canada, for those who haven't visited. So more to that point though, online, I started finding sort of, I would say, solidarity and camaraderie with other similarly situated archives. I'm by no means what I'm doing is new. It just happens to be new for Southern Ontario, and in essence, compiling, archiving, sharing stories of the African diaspora in Canada. A good deal of it is focused on my family's photos, just because I have so many. But I've definitely done calls, and I'm constantly always looking for photos. The aesthetic being, I'd say pre-2000s, pre-2000s, mid-90s and backwards. But as I was saying, I was able to connect with others doing the same thing. There's someone doing the same thing in like Miami, Florida, someone doing the same thing in like Virginia, someone doing the same thing in New York. There's a huge page called Black Archives. And that's someone that I can call a friend, Renata. And, she's doing amazing things in terms of collaborating with various mass media organizations. But the power of Black media and the community aspect, these are the people that were encouraging me and showing me what to do and how to do it. And also just sort of reaffirming what I knew deep down in my spirit, which was that it's important to share these stories. It's important that Black-handed moments are shared and discussed, and not only moments specifically tailored to entertaining people. I think that they helped me, in essence, articulate an artistic vision and also sort of, I would say, a moral philosophy. So that's the second example of how it helped me. It's just the second example of, I'd say, the archive's connection to Blackness. And then last, I think I'd be remiss not mention, with this archive, I was really exposed to, gratefully, the essentiality of Black female leadership. And what I mean by that is that at every turn and every way, with all due respect to everyone, it was Black women that were showing me what to do next and that were showing me how to go about it and were helping me to elevate my standards time again. And the first person that truly took notice of my archive, when I started the archive, it was with zero fanfare whatsoever. I just set up a page and I think maybe I shared a photo. Photo is an amazing photo. It was one of my grandfather's photos of Waterloo in the late 60s. Shot on a very particular camera. It's got a very particular color. It's very period piece. But no one noticed it. But Glo Dien, who works at the Contemporary Art Forum for Kitchener Area Kafka, she noticed it, and she told someone else in Toronto about it, who is also was a Black woman in the leadership position of an arts organization, and then that individual reached out to me, and that was Karen Carter, and she was at the time the executive director for Band Gallery, Black Artist Network and Dialogue Toronto. And Karen Carter right away said, I'm going to help you set up an exhibit in Toronto. And Karen brought me to the Gladstone, And then when Karen decided, she said, you know, let's meet in person. She came down to Kitchener from Toronto, like, oh, I didn't even know there was Black people here. Like, what's going on? And, you know, I had a conversation with Karen, and she brought her colleague, who's a you know, a professional Black woman who sits on boards in Toronto and arts boards and is an art administrator. And then these women were showing me what's what. And then I ended up taking an internship with BAN because I was very much the novice in this visual arts world. And all my staff members were just amazing, strong, powerful Black women that were showing me. I was literally the lowest rung of the ladder in terms of knowledge. And that didn't make a difference because of the circle that I had been fortunate enough to be placed within. And I have just examples abound of that sort of energy and essential energy. But I am forever grateful because with this archive, I was able to, you know, be reminded of what matters and also just open myself up to the humility of learning and being reminded of what makes our people special. I didn't really have much more images or much more dialogue beyond that. I apologize, but did anyone have any questions for me?
Thank you for that, Aaron. So like Aaron mentioned, if you do have questions, we are going to have our questions addressed at the end of the presentation. So please do not hesitate to put them in the question and answer box and we will get to them at the end. Thank you again, Aaron, for that. And just listening to you and just, it really resonates, especially because in this age of social media, it's like you could start something small and end up with a huge maze of a huge following and audience simply because you started something. While in the past when we didn't have all these mediums, it's connecting and building that community in your little space wasn't as easy as it is now. So especially within the Black community. And I'll talk a bit about that, I'll sort of pick your brain a bit on that during the Q&A session, but I do appreciate you speaking on that. So thank you. Thank you, Aaron. My next speaker and my final speaker is Clive Forrester. Clive is a continuing lecturer with the Department of English here at Waterloo and specializes in forensic linguistics, which combines aspects of law with linguistic theory. His research includes courtroom discourse analysis, Creole linguistics, the relationship between language, gender, and sex, and language advocacy policy. Please join me in welcoming Clive Forrester.
Thank you very much, Akua. And thank you to the panelists who went before me. You know, I really enjoyed your presentations, and I'm glad to be here to talk a little bit about the kind of work that I've been doing, you know, since being here in Canada and even before. You know, when I graduated with my PhD in linguistics. So the title of my talk, I guess I would call it From Plantation to Parliament, the Road to Official Language Recognition for Caribbean Creole Languages. And, you know, I'm not sure how familiar the audience might be with what a Creole language is, but a Creole language is simply any language which emerged out of a contact situation between two or more divergent linguistic groups. So if you can imagine a context where two groups who speak, you know, a completely different language came together and eventually a new language emerged out of that contact situation years later, that new language would be a Creole language. On the surface of it, there is nothing linguistically deficient about Creole languages. However, the context in which Caribbean Creole languages emerged has played a large part in the way that people view Caribbean Creole languages. And that's why persons like myself, and really and truly anyone else who is from the Caribbean and, you know, outside the Caribbean, need to consider their role as advocates for these particular languages. Now, when you hear about a language advocate, for many persons, this seems very unusual. You grow up speaking a particular language and it never occurs to you that you would need to advocate for this language. It never occurs to you that there might be persons who challenge whether or not the way you speak is indeed a legitimate language. This has been the case for Caribbean indigenous languages forever, right? Very early in the history of the Caribbean, the lives of indigenous Caribbean people were interrupted, really and truly, by European colonization. And through European colonization, a lot of the indigenous languages which were spoken in the Caribbean were either dispersed, decimated, or simply forbidden to be used, simply because the European powers established their languages in these territories. As a part of European colonization, we had West Atlantic slavery, right? The Atlantic slave trade. And this went on for hundreds of years. During that plantation system is where we have Caribbean Creole languages emerging. And the bulk of the Caribbean Creole languages are languages which have aspects of West African syntax and West African words, along with European words. So what you find emerging is a language which has features both of the European colonizing language as well as the West African languages that the West Africans, the enslaved Africans, would have brought to the Caribbean. When those languages emerged, of course, they were seen as inferior languages, obviously, because the persons who spoke those languages were seen as inferior people. And this went on for many years, even up until the point of independence in the 60s for many Caribbean territories, around the time of the early 1960s, 1962 for Jamaica, 1964 for a few other Caribbean territories, the British speaking former colonies. This was a time of the kind of resurgence of Black power, Black consciousness, and Black liberation. And of course, attention was turned to the various markers of Caribbean identity, language being one of them. And there was a kind of resurgence in pride in the early part of the 1960s for Caribbean indigenous folk forms, as well as Caribbean language. But this didn't last very long. By the time a person like me entered the public school system, well, I don't want to age myself, but I'm a child of the 80s. So I grew up in the 80s. And one of the things that was kind of puzzling to me was the fact that on the one hand, our teachers would encourage us to perform Jamaican poetry using Jamaican Creole, right? The language that we grew up with. We would perform poems, we would sing, we would play games. But if we dared to answer a question that the teacher asked, when she asks a question, she's using her best version of English. If we dared to answer that question in Jamaican Creole, we would be in trouble. And in some cases, unfortunately, we would be punished. And this punishment could range from a very stern correction all the way up to physical punishment. And I've seen this being administered on children in my classroom. So can you imagine growing up as a child in the Caribbean? You predominantly speak a Creole language, and you are in the school system, and you are trying your best to participate, but you know that your participation has to be done in the language that you're comfortable with. You would like to participate, you'd like to answer a question, you would like to demonstrate to your classmates and your teacher that you are engaged and you know what's going on and you have the right answer, but you have to keep silent because there is this fear that if you use the language that you are most comfortable with, you'll be punished, you'll be mocked, you might be seen ironically as someone who's not very intelligent, even though you might have the correct answer. So what happened, certainly by the time that I got to high school, you know, there was this, what they would call a language problem, certainly in Jamaica, and it was described as a language problem all across various Caribbean territories. What was the language problem that these ministries of education noticed? What they noticed was that the vast majority of children entering the public school system in a lot of these Caribbean territories spoke a language, a Creole language, on entering the school system. Even though there was this kind of assumption that children had a fairly good grasp of the existing colonial language, which might have been English in the case of Jamaica, French in the case of Haiti, and you know, Dutch in the case of Curacao, and so on, and Dutch in Suriname. But what was happening was that all of these children were entering the school system with a language other than the European language. And because the approach to language teaching in the school system of these previously colonial territories was never catered to allowing this kind of bilingual, biliteracy approach to education, what you found was that a lot of these children were falling through the cracks. When I was leaving high school, I actually wanted to do law. Because, you know, when you speak a lot and you are outspoken, people just push you into that career. And it seemed like a very glamorous career, to tell the truth, based on what I saw on television, right? So I applied to law, and of course I was rejected. You know, I was not successful, and I was scooped up into linguistics. And at the time, there was this big drive to get all the law rejects together and enroll them into linguistics. And I ended up in that batch of students who got into linguistics. I actually wanted to jump ship and get back into law, but I was doing fairly well in linguistics. And at the end of my undergraduate degree, a professor said to me, there's actually a branch of linguistics which investigates the intersection between language and the law. It's called forensic linguistics, and you should consider doing a master's in that area. Went on to do the master's and then the PhD, focusing on discourse inside the Jamaican courtroom, specifically looking at how judges understood witnesses who spoke exclusively or predominantly Jamaican Creole. How well did the judges in the Jamaican courtroom understand these speakers? That was my concern. So why is it overall necessary to engage in this kind of work, you know, advocating for Caribbean languages? Well, firstly, there is a value in learning about your own language. As we heard from Aaron just now, he embarked on this journey, finding out things about his Jamaican heritage through his photography, through the production of his documentary, to reconnect with his culture. Many times, persons feel disconnected from different aspects of their culture, and it is very important to, you know, whether you are a linguist, a non-linguist, to advocate for these very important things, because there's a value in appreciating the language and appreciating other artifacts of culture. The second reason why it is important to engage in this kind of work is for the potential improvements in language education as it relates to using a bilingual or biliteracy approach. Too many children are falling through the cracks in the Caribbean as it relates to their proficiency with literacy. And a large part of this is a kind of, you know, stubbornness and ignorance on the part of many persons involved in the ministries of education, which, you know, have to do with teaching language. The third reason why it is important to engage in this kind of work is that when we do language advocacy, it brings us a step closer to unlocking the full economic potential of Caribbean territories, Caribbean individuals, and persons in the diaspora. Since I've been here in Canada, I have also continued to do this important language advocacy work. In 2008, when I just came to Canada, I came here as a visiting professor at York University, and I launched courses on Jamaican Creole. So I was actually teaching Jamaican language courses, three of them, all the way up until, you know, I came here in 2016 to the University of Waterloo. During that time, I've worked as a consultant on legal cases, most recently in 2018, when I served as an expert witness in a Toronto murder case that involved evidence which came via wiretap from a person who was speaking Jamaican Creole. I've done several presentations for different Jamaican organizations, trying to infuse that same kind of enthusiasm that I have for my language into members who might be attending these various public forums that I will go to from time to time to talk about language, to explain to persons the history behind Jamaican language and its importance and why we need to preserve this language. And in fall this year, 2022, I will be teaching language, life, and literature in the Caribbean. One of the first courses that I've developed here at the University of Waterloo as a part of the Black Studies Diploma. So anybody who is watching this, you can come and register to do this course. Tell your mother, tell your father, tell your friend that there's going to be a course investigating language in the Caribbean from an authentic speaker of Creole language in the Caribbean, Jamaican Creole in particular. And that may have to say, respect. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Clive, for that presentation, and I'll sort of dig a bit into your insights in the Q&A session, which we are delving into right now. So I'll repeat, if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A chat box and we will address them. So I believe there is one question in here, and it's for Nancy. So Nancy, the question goes, I wondered if you had an example of disaggregated data being effectively used in evolving useful policies to advance equity. In my organization, which is the Region of Waterloo Arts Fund, we are considering starting to get data regarding race and gender, but we have some qualms about how to go about it. Could you give any suggestions?
Well, thank you there, Akua. I think I'm not right in that. Okay. So a very good one where I'm sitting now in Accra, Ghana, when we were refugees here, we got to a point where the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, there's not much education sometimes around what refugees is and how they are looked at, that there's a lot of issues that goes on there. There were a lot of assumptions around that, and these are real individuals who have come from real tough parts of the world with war and so. So we did, that research was done, and the results, I can say, was very good, because refugees were restored those very basic needs that you think it's survival. But at the University of Manitoba, another example was for employment equity, right? Where the then dean looked at how what he saw was there was more white students and more white faculty or professors, but of course less black students to that. And that was done, and from there, they started to have more employment of more black or so professors or other professors of color, and of course students. And he did a wonderful work with making it more pictorial and visual in terms of dividing the percentage. So he didn't only say for students of color. So he divided into four sections, 25% each, and there were 25% allotted to white students, 25% to students of color and other groups, minority groups of sort, and individuals with disability and indigenous students, the same he did with faculty. So disaggregated data really helps, especially on these sort of racial lines. And even here at the University of Waterloo, the equity data survey, right, it's going to do a lot of wonderful work by the time all is sort of finalized and so forth. Yeah.
Thank you, Nancy. So I have another question, and this is for Clive. Can you speak more to on why the Caribbean Creole languages have received such interest in academia now than before, and why this current culture or climate may be more receptive to recognizing these languages like we do their European counterparts?
Okay, all right. Thank you for that question. Whoever asked a question, this sounds like somebody who might be familiar with what is happening in linguistics. Now, I think a large part of the, sustained academic interest in Caribbean languages has its genesis in the formation of the Society for Caribbean Linguistics. So right now, I'm the secretary of that organization, the Society for Caribbean Linguistics, which is celebrating their 50th anniversary this year. So in many ways, the older heads in linguistics were the ones who at that original meeting in the early 1970s, it might have been 1972, that they had discussions before that in the latter part of the 60s. I think it was the foundational members of the Society for Caribbean Linguistics who started to turn a genuine academic gaze on Caribbean languages, which was very different from the kind of academic attention which Caribbean languages received prior to that. Prior to that, Caribbean indigenous languages, the Creole languages, were simply viewed as something which was odd, as different, as unusual in their syntax, unusual in their typological categorizations, especially in comparison to their European counterparts. But it was in the early part of the 70s that you saw the older heads, so to speak, the foundational members of the Society for Caribbean Linguistics, who started to put a genuine and serious and sustained academic interest in the Caribbean languages. And what they did was that they spawned graduate students, myself being one, supervised by one of the original older heads, Professor Hubert Devenish, to carry on this work. So that is one of the reasons why I think that has happened. I'm not sure if there was a second part to the question, but I think a large part of the current academic interest has a lot to do with the Society for Caribbean Linguistics and those foundational members who were involved in its formation, Professor Hubert Devenish, Lawrence Carrington, Professor Ian Roberts, all of those persons were instrumental in the serious study of Caribbean languages.
Thank you for that, Clive. So just looking through the Q&A here, I have one personal question that I wanted to pose to the entire panel. I'll start with you, Erin, and I know you spoke a bit about it when you were talking, but what are some interesting discovery or insights that your work or research as it applies to the Black experience in Canada, and how has that heightened in the past couple of years leading to today? And can you give examples of this?
Sure. sort of the thesis that I approached my curation with was that Black people have candid moments, joyful moments, family moments, moments of camaraderie. And this is true, but I think maybe I projected my own experience on others because my grandfather was sort of like a technologist. So we captured more moments than most people that I approach for photos. And so I've tried really hard to not make the archive based strictly on my family. And it's like, I'm very conscious of it, right? I'm very like, I want, so I'm constantly asking, you know, like I grew up with a ton of Black people in Kitchener-Waterloo, even like from people that I would call cousins that aren't, but I would say, hey, you know, can I get some photos for the archive? And sometimes the responses I get are like, I don't have them. Or I remember getting a response like, oh, they're with my mom and I'm not talking to my mom right now. Or, well, I don't know where they are. Like, so it was, you know, and so I was able to get, you know, photos from others, absolutely. But I thought I'd be able to get so much more, because when I go and look through the photos, I have photos of people that aren't even family members. We have them collected, you know, and that's as a result of my grandfather's approach to collecting photos and being a photographer. And so I just assumed like, oh, this archive, well, there's so many people of African descent, Kitchener-Waterloo. I'm gonna have so many photos to go through. And it's actually been the reverse. And it's been a challenge finding like high quality photos in sort of the informal settings, such as that I have access to personally.
Thank you, Aaron. Does anyone sort of want to pitch in on that?
Could you just repeat the question again, Akua?
Sure. Are there any interesting insights or discoveries that you discovered with your work, and as it relates to culture in the Canadian context, and how has this heightened over the past couple of years, so literally the past 2 years?
Okay, so I guess maybe two things. So one of the first things was the kind of interest that persons in the diaspora in general and in Canada have about learning Caribbean languages, right? Which was kind of surprising. So all the time that I was at York University teaching Jamaican Creole, the classes were full all the time. I had to be turning away students each year, right? And people were enthused that there was such a course at the university. In fact, it was actually students in the Caribbean Studies program that got Jamaican Creole at York University. So when you're a student in the Caribbean Studies program, you have to do a language which is spoken in the Caribbean other than English to fulfill your language requirement. At that time at York University, the only other languages spoken in the Caribbean that were not English that were taught at York was French and Portuguese. So the Caribbean students say, oh no, we want a Creole language. And it was out of that you know, Jamaican Creole came to York University. So one of the first things that I guess was a pleasant surprise was the interest that persons have in, you know, doing a language course in Jamaican language. And I suspect it would have been the case for other Caribbean languages as well, because people genuinely want to reconnect with certain aspects of their culture, especially second and third generation Caribbean nationals, right? You know, people who identify as second and third generation Caribbean persons, because they weren't born in the Caribbean. Their parents migrated here and, you know, they grew up in Canada, but they definitely want that authentic connection with the Caribbean, whether it be Jamaica, Barbados, Trinidad, Guyana, you name it. And a part of that is learning a language. The other thing that I discovered, which, you know, I suspected that might be the case, but I was kind of surprised at how many times there might be a person who is involved, whether as a witness or, you know, or the accused, in a courtroom here in Canada who might be a speaker of a Caribbean Creole language. So I'm actually in the process of, you know, completing a book talking about just the existence of Jamaican Creole inside the Canadian courtroom system. You know, what happens when somebody gets on the stand, the kinds of cases that I've worked with, and the potential for gross misinterpretation. And you know, unfortunately, you know, you might have a case of a miscarriage of justice if these things aren't handled delicately and with a kind of expert lens on the nuances of the language situation, right? So I guess it would be those two things: the interest of persons to learn the language, and the number of times that you might find a speaker in a Canadian courtroom who their language that they're most comfortable with is actually a Creole language from the Caribbean.
Thank you so much, Clive. I could go on for hours sitting and chatting with all of us simply because it just resonates with you. And in this information age and social media, it's so easy to get connected. And as much as we may be far from home, all these platforms sort of bring us closer and allowing us to embrace our heritage, embrace who we are, and really get connected to our roots. So I really appreciate this conversation today. And I just want to say thank you to all our speakers today. This past hour, we've allowed ourselves to embrace the learnings of others. And it's my hope that the research shared, showcased the different aspects of Black culture in Canada. And it's also my hope that these experiences continue to simmer with us, encouraging us all to show up as active allies in the spaces that we occupy. I would like to thank the panel again, Erin Francis, Clive Forrester, Nancy Reeves, for taking a moment today to share your research, to share your experiences with the Waterloo community and beyond. And also I'd like to say a big thank you to our crew, Megan, Sarah, and Wendy, who kept the ground and kept things going in the background. So thank you to everyone. Please join us next week, Thursday, February the 18th, for the Department of History speaker series at 11 a.m. And this will be with Dr. Barrington Walker, who is the Associate Vice President, Equity, Diversity and Inclusion at Wilfrid Laurier University. Again, I'd like to say thank you to everyone. Stay safe and have a good rest of your day. Bye now.